Joining us is Professor Corey Brettschneider. He's the author of The Oath and the Office, A Guide to the Constitution for Future Presidents. He's a professor of political science at Brown, visiting professor of law at Fordham Law School, has a great piece in the Washington Post. Want to talk to you about that, if you don't mind.
It sounds good. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for doing this.
My pleasure.
It's the... We're deep in the summer, and somebody would rather be outside with his daughter.
Bailey? My dog?
Do you know that Elizabeth Warren has a dog named Bailey?
I think you sent me that. That's hysterical.
Yeah. Before we get to Mueller and your piece in the Washington Post, the president's comments about Baltimore being a rodent-infested city that no human would live in, his attacks on the squad, telling four congresswomen of color to go back to where they came from. In normal circumstances, would those statements in and of themselves rise to the level of an impeachable offense?
I think it's a great question. In the book, I kind of early on talk about the bully pulpit, and I try to talk about it not in the usual way. The usual point that's made about it is that it's an expansion of presidential power because all of a sudden the president can speak directly to the American people and lobby them to lobby Congress. And so it's seen as this moment when it's created as, you know, a very modern growth of the executive branch. But to me, like with that comes this moral responsibility to use the bully pulpit to defend values of equality under law. And the first person to really use the bully pulpit, it was created by Teddy Roosevelt, but it's really used for the first time by Woodrow Wilson. And he uses it basically for the ends of racism. He shows Birth of a Nation in the White House. He's quoted in there. He never denounces the film. In fact, he promotes it. And so that early on to me is an example of dangerous presidential speech. Now, can it be impeachable? The relevant question there, I think, the precedent that we've got, Wilson, of course, was seen as a great hero, unfortunately, in my view, a mistake. But the person that was impeached partly for his speech was Andrew Johnson. And in the 10th article of impeachment, they talk about these speeches that he was giving around the country, and they talk about the fact that he disparaged Congress. But really, they don't mention it explicitly, but what they're getting at is that he was disparaging Congress for protecting civil rights. And so it really was this deeply racist speech. And yes, there was an article of impeachment devoted to his speech. So I've said repeatedly on the show and in that chapter that in the last chapter of the book on impeachment that presidential speech is one of the things that might count as an impeachable offense. And certainly the president here goes beyond even Wilson and Andrew Johnson. So my answer is that was a long wind up to a big yes.
If you look at Latin America, impeachment is in and of itself political. Dilma Rousseff gets impeached over a technicality. You can impeach a president for any reason you want.
Yes, there's a political philosopher, Danielle Allen, who has a piece in the Washington Post saying we should be leery of calling it political because you don't want to be overly neutral about what is good or bad reasons for impeachment. And I agree with that. But let me clarify for a second. The fact is that the court doesn't oversee impeachment. And so in that sense, it's political. It's a solely political decision. But I think what Allen is getting at, in my view, is there are better or worse reasons within that political process for impeachment. And there still is a moral standard that has to be thought of, not by the courts, but by Congress, of high crimes and misdemeanors. So I don't think that the example of Brazil, I think that's an example of a bad impeachment. And there is such a thing. My understanding from what I've followed in that case is that it probably wasn't deserved. But that's not to say certainly that the only impeachable offenses are criminal offenses. And so I think you can have good impeachable offenses that are not crimes. And in Trump's case, certainly that those statements qualify. I guess a kind of sharper way to say it is it's political in the sense that it's not reviewable by courts, but there still is a constitutional standard.
There's a constitutional standard. William Rehnquist was the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, and he presided over the Clinton impeachment. John Roberts, another Republican, will preside, hopefully, over the Trump impeachment. A judge is a judge. And if this is a trial, couldn't Roberts conceivably rule, make decisions that favor Trump?
Yes, you're right. When I say it's political in the sense that it's not up to the court, there is this odd structure where the impeachment in the House is conducted by the House. But then there is something called a trial, which is confusing because it's not a legal trial. It's a sort of quasi-trial in the Senate. And the person who presides over that trial, exactly as you say, is the Chief Justice, and that would be Roberts in this case. The difference is that the normal rules of legal procedure don't apply. So in the 19th century, in the Johnson trial, this issue comes up where the Senate wants to override the Chief Justice. And, you know, I think the consensus is that the Senate actually can do that. Now, there's no equivalent in law.
What do you mean override? Oh, because the trial takes place in the Senate, not the House.
Correct. The impeachment happens in the House. It's a majority vote.
What are the steps? First, it goes into the House. What do you need to get to the Senate?
So in the House of Representatives, you need a majority to impeach. And impeachment is sort of analogous to an indictment, you might say. It's the beginning of the accusation. And then there is something called the trial, but it's not a legal trial. The Senate has a process where they're going to evaluate whether the president should be removed or not after the impeachment. And there the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court presides, but it's not a legal trial. It's really up to the members to make decisions. And my understanding as well, based on a precedent from the Andrew Johnson impeachment, the other huge difference is that if there's a decision by the Chief Justice, I think a majority or supermajority of the Senate could override that decision. So those are the technicalities that have to be worked out.
And these are Senate rules. This is not found in the Constitution.
Well, what is found are the votes. So that's the majority in the House and the 2/3 in the Senate is in the Constitution. And the fact that the Chief Justice presides is also in the Constitution. But there are detailed questions about how the procedure is going to work that are not laid out by the Constitution, including that puzzle that I just brought up.
Conceivably, if you had a democratically controlled Senate and somebody, Roberts may turn out to be more conservative than we think, is it conceivable that the president could appeal the impeachment and go to the judge, say to the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, I want to appeal this, it's unconstitutional, and because the Chief Justice is a Republican, he's going to let the Supreme Court decide whether or not he's removed from office as opposed to the Senate?
I think the consensus among scholars, one of the best books is a guy named Yale law professor who's passed away called Charles Black, wrote a book just called Impeachment. And his argument there, and I don't think there's any dispute about this, is that no, there's no judicial review of impeachment, that the final word is given in this case to the Constitution. Now, could the court...
To the Senate. The final word is given to the Senate.
Correct. To the Congress and to the Senate, right? That there is no review by courts. But could some overzealous court, you know, say otherwise? I guess so. But I think that's unlikely. And to me, I think Charles Black is right. It's not reviewable.
You know, these are things, and I'll get to this later. I'm kind of pissed off at your profession. These are things that should be known already. These are big issues.
I'm doing what I can. I'm on your show all the time, and I wrote my book. But yes, absolutely. Justice O'Connor said that there's a crisis, basically, in America, which is civic education, and that at some point, the sort of common civics class that taught about the way that the system worked, so that you just, as a matter of basic education, learned about the Constitution, learned about processes like impeachment, disappeared. And one of the reasons why I did the book is trying to bring that back. I wrote it in a way that certainly could be taught in high schools, and I'm starting to see it on the AP class, government syllabus. You know, that's part of what we're trying to do here. And
right.
You're trying to do it, too, by making it occasionally funny.
Yeah, I wasn't criticizing you and your profession for not knowing something. I'm criticizing the legal profession for not arriving at any settled law when it comes to House oversight and exactly how an impeachment takes place.
It's so rare, David, that it's been used. I mean, really, we're talking about two instances where there actually was an impeachment. So that's the Johnson administration and the Clinton example, and one where there was a serious threat and likely there would have been an impeachment and removal. That's the Nixon case. But aside from that, you know, it just is so rare. And so we're, you know, there was a long time where people sort of assumed, oh, presidents, you know, certainly the Obama administration and before, that the violations of the Constitution weren't so severe that it called for this. And most of American history hasn't involved crises. There have been some, but you have to look, you know, back pretty far to really get to them.
I'm a little pissed off. I'm not trying to be rude to you.
I personally put it on the party that I have been a member of since, you know, I could vote, and that's the Democratic Party, and the Clinton impeachment. I think there was a lot of miseducation that went on there because the thought was that it was unjust, but it resulted in a sort of discussion of the process that was really misleading in a way that we're still suffering from. I'll give you some examples. Clinton's lawyer said that impeachable offenses had to be proven beyond a reasonable doubt. That's false. They said they had to be crimes. That's false. And there was also a contention that obstruction of justice wasn't sufficient for impeachment on its own, that there had to be an underlying crime. Also false. And
these are Clinton's lawyers saying that.
Yeah, I put it with the Clinton administration's defense of Clinton during that impeachment. I think that was a major miseducation. And you even saw during the Mueller hearings, which we haven't started talking about, but a Republican congressman citing Janet Reno approvingly in some context, which I think really speaks to where we are.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of House oversight, the fact that Elijah Cummings has to go to court to decide whether or not Bill Barr can withhold information, the notes on the census question, House oversight hasn't even been established firmly yet.
That's another huge discussion. But one of the things to come out of this, I hope, is a reinvigoration of the powers and the role of Congress. And so, you know, we just have slipped into a system where the executive branch is so huge, 2.5 million people, and the powers and staffing in Congress are so small in comparison that they really have been dwarfed by the executive branch, and the system that's supposed to involve oversight and separation of powers has been overcome. You saw that in the Wall case, and unfortunately things are going well for the president in that case, but he just completely usurped the power of Congress by neglecting their refusal to fund the wall, and he wants to build it anyway under the Emergencies Act. And you see it in the denial of the subpoenas. There is an erosion of the basic fundamentals of the system, of, again, the kind of thing you would learn in a normal high school civics class. But
yeah, I'm not criticizing.
That's not just Trump. I was going to say that again goes, I think, back to, you can find not exactly examples of avoiding subpoenas in Obama, but certainly the use of executive power and war powers. The impeachment example I gave in the example of Clinton. And I think there's sort of been a slow erosion. It doesn't go back to Nixon, because there was a response to Nixon's abuse of power during Carter and Ford that really did rein in the executive branch. And even during Reagan, there was a respect for you know, powers to request information. So it isn't just a Trump phenomenon. It's something that we've allowed to erode over time, really since the Reagan administration, since Clinton especially.
Right. Again, I'm not criticizing the way the law is taught. I'm criticizing lawyers, judges, and politicians for not arriving at settled law on some of these important constitutional issues. So let's start with the OLC letter. I have several questions. What is the OLC letter? What would Alexander Hamilton say if he were to discover that it was almost settled law that a sitting president couldn't be indicted? And what would Alexander Hamilton say if he discovered the decision that a sitting president couldn't be indicted was made not through law or a constitutional amendment, was made from a decision flowing from an internal Justice Department memo written by whom? Who wrote the memo?
It isn't settled law, and I think what you're saying is the reason why. It is just a memo written by a mid-level two officials in the Office of Legal Counsel, which is part of the Attorney General's office, which is part of the executive branch. And go figure, that office said that their boss, essentially the president, can't be indicted or charged with a crime while he or she is in office. But no court has said that, certainly not the Supreme Court. And there is no settlement in the law. To the contrary, my argument in my first Washington Post article about this was that it cuts the other way, that the legal precedents in U.S. v. Nixon and Clinton v. Jones suggests, and this is the word, the phrase that we're sick of hearing, but you know what? It's music to my ears that I was hearing it so much during the impeachment, that a president, no one is so high that they're above the law. And that's the phrase quoted in U.S. v. Nixon. And the idea was a president has to answer a criminal subpoena. They're not immune. And so this memo that is just an internal Justice Department policy, because this office within the Justice Department, the Office of Legal Counsel, said so twice during the Nixon and then repeated during the Clinton administration, that isn't law. That is just an opinion of the executive branch. And again, go figure that the executive branch is saying the president is immune. And Hamilton did think that because he thought that impeachment should come first and then a president could be indicted and tried after office. But there was just disagreement about that at the founding. So James Wilson from Pennsylvania said something to the equivalent of that a president is not above the law. So no, I don't think it's settled law. It is just an opinion from the Justice Department, and I think it's wrong. I think the law cuts the other way.
Yeah, you would think after 250 years we would figure this out. Every sitting president commits a crime.
Can I say something about that, about the settlement issue? Because it is, you're raising an important issue, but I guess I have a slightly different take on it, which is, you know, it is just a fact of constitutional law that there's a division in how to interpret the Constitution. You have originalism, the idea that you read the document the way it was understood at the time it was written. You have a more value-based idea, more evolving idea with the cases, that the principles evolve over time and are defined by courts in a broader way than was understood when they were written. That leads to 5-4 splits on decision after decision after decision. So I guess it's not a surprise to me, given how much we disagree about the meaning of the Constitution, that we disagree about so many of these fundamental issues. And then I don't think we can blame the framers either, because they couldn't really guess about everything ahead of time and come up with a concrete set of rules. They came up with principles that we then apply over time. And the good thing is that principles are expandable and useful in a variety of ways. The bad thing or the dangerous thing is that, no, there isn't settled law on many of these things. So that's just the sort of truth of the structure of constitutional law rather than something that somebody's to blame.
The miracle of the Constitution is that our founding fathers understood that men are inherently greedy and power hungry, and they put in a series of checks and balances to prevent one person from eclipsing the institutions and the American people. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, there was a sense that on the one hand, the Articles of Confederation were too weak. You want to have a government that can do stuff, tax and spend and solve problems. But you also have to see that there's a risk, which is that if you give all the power to one person, they could turn out to be bad, mm-hmm. a demagogue. That's the point of having all these checks. The point of, in general, having the law be over any one person in government. That was the main idea, I think, of the Constitution.
I think our founding fathers didn't understand the tribalism within the federal government and how institutions protect their own, that there is a tendency for people to stick together. I happen to believe that it's cloudy as to whether or not a sitting president can be indicted on purpose, because the Justice Department wants to protect their own. They want to protect the executive branch. Congress, I was reading the Al Franken story where they're trying to rehabilitate Al Franken's reputation in The New Yorker. It was written by Jane Mayer, who went to Yale. She's married to a guy who went to Harvard. It was published in The New Yorker, which is edited by David Remnick, who went to Princeton. And they went out of their way to try to clear Al Franken, Harvard. They try to clear his name. People stick together. And one of the things they wrote...
I was just going to say, that's certainly true in the case of the OLC memos to me, because that whole office, I mean, the idea that we've, and I think you were getting at this in the beginning, that we've sort of allowed the courts to defer to the executive branch when it comes to fundamental problems like, you know, war powers is one where courts have really refused to intervene when presidents haven't sought war declarations. They've said it's a political question and left it up to the other branches. And in general, the sort of power of the Office of Legal Counsel, here you see it because there isn't an independent counsel apart from the Justice Department looking into this. And so it's devolved to this office. And to me, it's such a common sense thing that you're spotting, but that many lawyers unfortunately don't realize, the legal system doesn't realize, that's dangerous because you have the executive checking itself. The idea of our system is supposed to be that you don't have people evaluating themselves. So, I mean, I'm a big fan of returning to that independent counsel law that operated during the Clinton administration that Clinton also destroyed, really, which was that you allowed an independent entity, the independent counsel, not a special counsel, who couldn't be fired by the president, to look into crimes or wrongdoing by the president. And that's a much better system. That person was appointed by a panel of judges and removable only if they didn't do their job well. And that's the system I'd like to see us return to. It's much truer to the idea of the constitutional idea that the branches don't check themselves.
Yeah, for a future discussion, I'd like to know why the Inspector General, there was the Inspector General Acts in the late 70s, where every government agency had an individual inspector general who would issue reports on malfeasance or possible malfeasance, and it hasn't been politicized. I see no reason they can't come up with an independent counsel that has the same bipartisanship as an inspector general. Why couldn't they do?
That was the idea. I mean, during Carter, they passed this post-Watergate reform that was exactly that. It was called the Independent Counsel Law. And the Independent Counsel looked into wrongdoing by the president or close associates of the president when it was thought that it was too close, the issues were too close to presidential power to allow the Justice Department to investigate. Now, that's the rule that operated during Iran-Contra. It functioned pretty well, in my opinion, functioned during the Carter administration, until Clinton. And the last really independent counsel, I believe he was the last, was Ken Starr. And that caused such a hubbub in the Clinton administration that they got rid of it. They didn't renew the law. And Clinton was so appalled by Starr's behavior that was the end of it. Now, you know, a separate discussion is whether Ken Starr did or didn't overreach. But getting rid of that was the reason why we're here. I believe the president would have been indicted under that old system because that those memos didn't bind the independent counsel. And so Ken Starr made it very clear in a memo that his office drafted, Brett Kavanaugh, by the way, was part of that group, that said, yes, you can indict a sitting president. It's one of the best statements of that view. I think if we still had that law, frankly, Trump would be on trial right now.
Right. Congressman Ken Buck, a Republican from Colorado, during the Mueller testimony asked, can you charge the president with a crime after he left office? What did Mueller answer?
Did you see my tweet when she did that?
Yeah, that's why I'm asking you the question.
I was so excited.
but here's, I'm going to be antagonistic.
Yeah.
What was Mueller's answer? And more importantly, why is it up to Mueller? Who elected Mueller to decide whether or not a sitting president can be charged with a crime after he left office? Again, don't you think after 200 years, we should know the answer to that question?
He, I think, can answer the question of whether he will be, because he's not the special counsel anymore. It'll be up to a future Justice Department. But I took the question to be set up to the question of whether or not it's possible once the president leaves office to try him or her. And ideally, the answer to that should be yes. Now, there's a huge problem with that, which is that there's a statute of limitations. This is what my Washington Post piece is about, of 5 years on obstruction of justice. So if the clock runs out, if he's elected to a second term, you know, if he loses this election, the answer is clearly yes. And I believe he likely will be tried for obstruction of justice. And one of the points of part two of the Mueller report was to keep the evidence fresh so that this could happen. That's what Mueller was really getting at, that yes, the president can be tried, and that's why we collected all this evidence, to enable that prosecution, also to enable impeachment if the Congress wanted to. He called it an alternative constitutional process. That clearly is impeachment, but it also allows for the prosecution in the event that the president loses the election. Now, if he wins the election, under the current rules, the statute of limitations is 5 years. So in all likelihood, he gets away with the crime and couldn't be tried. There is an argument that the Justice Department could try, which is that the statute of limitations tolls, or that's the technical term for suspended, because it wouldn't be fair to allow the president to get away with a crime. I don't happen to think that argument would work. I think he would get away with it if he wins a second term. And that, to me, is the reason to well, certainly vote against him, but more immediately to impeach and remove him to make sure that justice is served. That's what Hamilton was talking about when he said, you know, you have to remove the president, then he should be tried. He assumed that the president would be impeached and removed if he or she committed a crime. And he thought it was an obligation of Congress to do that. So if you hold the position that a president's immune from prosecution while in office, you have to, and the Justice Department should be saying this more clearly, you have to impeach and remove him.
Yeah, let me just try to understand this. You're saying that there's a statute of limitations on the crimes that Trump is alleged to have committed. Those would be the obstruction of justice crimes?
5 years.
And there's a 5-year statute of limitations on obstruction of justice. Jeffrey Epstein could have committed sexual assault on minors 30 years ago. He could still be. There's no statute of limitations on.
Right. Much more serious crimes. Murder, for instance, has no statute of limitations, but obstruction has a statute of limitations of 5 years.
Right. So it does make sense to freeze the charges until after the president leaves office, since he's going to be playing out the clock, and it incentivizes him not to leave office.
Right. But the system is so messed up right now that we don't have that exception. No court has ever said that or clarified that. I think the hope of people, if he won a second term, was that the courts would say that the statute of limitations is suspended. But I don't see the Supreme Court saying that. They're very pro-executive power, and they don't like adding exceptions and, you know, moralistic exceptions like this one is called equitable tolling. They tend not to like those ideas. So my prediction is that if we don't impeach and remove him now and he's reelected, that's it. He's going to get away with it.
Equitable tolling
right.
would be freezing the statute of limitations till he leaves office. Let me speak in favor of the, is it called the unitary power of the executive branch? Where people.
That's an expression that's sometimes used to describe this very strong view of executive power that people like John Yoo hold, that it tends to stress strong presidential power and few limits on the presidency.
Okay, so John Yoo might say every sitting president commits a crime, especially if John Yoo is writing a torture memo. He's the Berkeley professor, right, who gave us torture.
Yes. The most extreme example is Trump himself, who has said in the last week, I believe, I read Article 2 and it says I can do anything I want, meaning, you know, Article 1 sets up the Congress and limits it. Article 2 sets up the president and limits it. But his understanding, genius scholar, constitutional scholar that he is that the Constitution is all about the idea that he can do whatever he wants. That's what somebody evidently told him, or he got that out of some very creative reading of the Constitution.
Okay, so there are some who would say every sitting president commits a crime that they theoretically could be charged with after they leave office, like Obama in 2010 ordered the assassination of an American citizen in Yemen. Anwar al-Awlaki was 16 years old. He was not charged with a crime, convicted of a crime, but the CIA, under President Obama's orders, carried out a successful drone strike and killed an American citizen in 2011. So theoretically, Barack Obama could be brought up on murder charges once he leaves office. And I believe that if that happened, a reasonable Supreme Court would rule that Barack Obama, as a private citizen, could not be charged with the crime that he committed as president, because it would set a bad precedent that any time any future president would have to conduct business with the threat of a criminal conviction hanging over his head or her head, and they wouldn't be able to perform their duties as commander-in-chief. So it wouldn't hold up in court.
There's a case about this called Fitzgerald, and it's about during the Nixon administration, the firing of a judge, and the judge sued Nixon saying that the firing was unjust and that he was entitled to compensation from Nixon. The precedent there, which is pretty close to what you're saying, and I think it's a sort of reasonable way to look at the issue, is it never said anything about absolute immunity from all things for sitting presidents or presidents after they leave office. But it did say that when you're doing something in the course of your official duties, that's different, that there's a sort of carve out for immunities when it comes to official acts as president. So if you, you know, signed a bill that turned out to have environmental harm, or you could take your pick of any of the millions of things that the president does as president, that there's an immunity there. But the case itself is very careful to say that there are things that are at the outer perimeter of your official duties or non-official duties. And, you know, those things you're not going to be protected from. So if you murder somebody, that's not okay. And to me, obstruction of justice is not an official government duty. It's the opposite. It's sort of undermining the office. And so I don't think there's an immunity
right.
for that.
But you know, I'm not
it is a great question. And you probably, without maybe you are realizing it or maybe subconsciously, remember the discussion of Fitzgerald from mm-hmm. The Oath in the Office.
Right, right.
Which I know you've memorized.
Yes, I have. You know, Kennedy, when he first came into office, authorized the Bay of Pigs operation, which was illegal. It was the CIA overthrowing a sovereign state. It got leaked to the New York Times, and Kennedy picked up the phone and asked them to hold the story. I mean, that's illegal. But as commander-in-chief, he's forgiven because these are national security issues that he decides unilaterally who we invade, when we invade, and how much the American people need to know based on his prerogative. That's keeping us safe from other countries. You bring up the Emergency Act. There are all these emergency acts. The Supreme Court just ruled that Donald Trump could take $2.5 billion out of the Pentagon and build his stupid wall with that because it's an emergency. He can declare a domestic emergency. What is
it's a very interesting, bizarre, and kind of twisted history. There's one act in particular called the Emergencies Act that's passed after Nixon. And the idea is that we need to get clearer on when presidents can use their emergency power and when they can't. And there had been some case law about this. I believe you and I talked about the Youngstown case that says that the president can't declare an emergency if the Congress has denied a certain right. The president can't just override the Congress's denial of a president's power on the grounds of inherent emergency. Anyway, the Congress wanted to make it clear that if the Congress said no, the president couldn't do something. So they passed a law that said that a president can declare an emergency, but a majority of both houses without the president could say no and could stop that. Now, the problem with the way the Emergencies Act was working is that there was a challenge to another law called CHADA, where the House of Representatives on its own wanted to use certain powers to deny, this is a separate issue in immigration, to deny decisions by the executive branch. Anyway, long story short, this case, CHADA, resulted in a ruling that said, we've got to be careful about Congress taking on decisions that aren't in the formal mode of presenting laws to the president passed by both houses where the president gets to sign or veto the law. And a lower court said the problem with the Emergencies Act is it's never been given to the president. The Congress doesn't have this constitutional power to just say no to the president through this kind of resolution. That's not in the Constitution. They have to give the president the chance to sign and veto, and if there's a veto and an override, they sort of reasserted the Schoolhouse Rock version of how Congress and the president are supposed to relate to each other. Anyway, long story short, the Congress, to try to comply with this ruling, changed the Emergencies Act so that the resolutions passed by the House and the Senate had to go to the president for signature or veto. And that's why even if the Senate and the House wanted to stop this emergency, the president would have the ability to veto that decision. So here's the bottom line. This law was meant to stop presidential power from getting too big and instead wound up just aggrandizing it.
Right. Yes. And I have two more questions. You've been very generous with your time. It's the summer. You should be out at a water park picking up E. coli with your daughter somewhere. Did you have too much faith in Robert Mueller? What was his responsibility to the American people? Shouldn't he have been clear and said outright, we found 10 possible counts of obstruction. but because he's a sitting president, we can't indict. So we recommend Congress pursue this through impeachment. What made it so hard for Robert Mueller to say that in no uncertain terms?
I wish I knew. I mean, I completely agree. And he took it to absurd lengths, the lack of ability to do that. When he was asked by, I can't remember who it was, what did you mean by, it's time for an alternative, that there's a possible alternative constitutional process since we can't indict? And he wouldn't answer the question. Of course, it's impeachment.
The thing you just said, is it impeachment? The thing you just said, he wouldn't even say the word impeachment.
I mean, it was, just ridiculous. I mean, and I'd go beyond that, which is to say, fine, if he thought the memos were binding on him, which I don't think they necessarily were, because the special counsel is supposed to have an independence that I think arguably doesn't make the memos binding on him. And I made that argument several times before while the report was being written. I think what he could have done, though, even if he thought the memos were binding on him, is A, recommend impeachment, as you said. He could have done another thing, which is say to Bill Barr, you as attorney general are not subject to memos written in an office that's way below your rank, and you should override them. You should say, I'm as attorney general deciding that this is such an egregious case that I'm going to bring charges against the sitting president. Now, we know there's no way that Bill Barr, hack that he is, would do that, but Mueller could have recommended it, and then when Barr refused, the case for impeachment would have been even stronger. So I'm totally disappointed and think that he, in an effort to seem, neutral and not biased, has gone overboard.
From the beginning, you've been calling for his impeachment. From the second Pelosi took the gavel, you've been saying she should start impeachment. We're going to have Mark Savasco on the show, Ted Lieu's chief of staff.
Yeah, Ted Lieu was great. Ted amazing. Lieu. One of the best.
Yeah.
And I wrote to Mark to tell him and tweeted it out. And I thought that was an amazing performance. What Lieu did was artful. He went through each of the elements of the crime of obstruction of justice and used the evidence in the report to try to show that Mueller's, even though he wouldn't say the words, had proven that the president committed obstruction of justice, the crime of obstruction of justice, beyond a reasonable doubt, and that each of these elements was fulfilled. It was an amazing performance. And seeing the stuff the next day that suggested that this was somehow a failure, I mean, you just had to look at that and see it. And also look, of course, at the first question that Congressman Nadler asked at the outset of the hearing, which is, did you exonerate the president? The answer was no. Those two things alone made it a success, in my view. And all this stuff about movies and was it fun to watch? It's like, give me a break. This congressman just showed that the president is guilty beyond a reasonable doubt of obstruction of justice. Amazing job.
Yeah, yeah. I thought Nadler did a pretty good job.
He did, yeah.
It was very disciplined, and each Democratic congressman outlined one charge of obstruction of justice in their questioning. Very disciplined.
Yeah.
Nearly half of the House Democrats are now openly supporting impeachment since the hearings. I'm surprised how quickly it's gaining steam. Is Trump goading the Democrats to impeach because it's going to die in the Senate? Then he can spin it as a complete and total exoneration, put it all behind him, and get reelected. What is your sense of the low information voter? Could Trump succeed in spinning this impeachment as an exoneration when it dies in the Senate? Or are the American people smart enough to know that the only reason he wasn't removed is because Republicans in the Senate would keep a turd in the Oval Office if it promised to cut taxes for the richest 1%.
I think it's how it's done. We have to be careful about it. And one suggestion, certainly he's going to try to do that, Trump, no question about it. And he's already trying. But two points. One is there's an interesting proposal by Lawrence Tribe that suggests, they can impeach without sending it to the Senate. So they could create a form of censure. It makes it clear that the president's committed an impeachable offense, but the House doesn't have faith in the trial in the Senate, and so they're not sending it to the Senate. That's my understanding of his proposal, which is very interesting. I guess in general, my worry about exoneration is that if they don't impeach, then Trump will spin that as an exoneration. And I think the American people are likely to believe that, because if he is guilty, why did they not? What's the explanation for no impeachment? So I think the real danger is in not acting, because mm-hmm. that looks to me like a exoneration.
Right. Andrew Jackson was censured, and that censure was later overturned. So you can overturn a censure, but once you're thrown out of office, you're gone.
Right.
Last question, I promise. And then you can...
It's overtime.
I know. And it will be reflected in your pay.
It's, well, which you're holding for me.
At FU. It's part of your FU pension.
Thank you, Dean.
Okay. Presidents, their second terms are always a death by a thousand cuts. It was for Nixon. It was for Reagan. Not so much for Obama, but it was for George W. Bush. The second a president is reelected, he's a lame duck. Everyone is abandoning ship. So here's my theory, then I want you to comment on this. Trump is offering the American people reality television, a show. And the American people, including you and me, Elaine Olin from The Washington Post has admitted to this, we all want to see something we've never seen before. Whether the voters know it or not, they want to see something that is unprecedented. So if Trump, if he's not reelected, then the show becomes, will he go to jail? That's a good show, right?
Yeah.
You know, so the lead up to November 3rd, 2020 is, does Trump go to jail after this? He was the one who said, lock her up. Well, are we going to hear a chance of lock him up? That is American politics. That's something we've never seen before.
I mean, that's, you know, you and I have talked about this and the danger of it. I mean, I am certainly for clearing the way to that prosecution. There is a sort of mode of talking about it that I'm very worried about, which is making it exactly a campaign slogan that we're voting to put him in jail. Because, you know, we can have laws that protect justice, that protect independence, but we don't vote up or down on whether somebody's deprived of their liberty. That's a criminal justice process. So, I think what you're saying is a possibility, but that's certainly not something I want to go along with.
You know, Michael Flynn led the chant, lock her up.
I remember, terrible. And yeah. We rightly criticized him. And in general, not just there, but we want to be very careful of the Democrats winning. And all of a sudden, all the people like me who were worried about constitutional issues suddenly say, oh, the president can do whatever he wants. Mm-hmm. It's not that Trump would be right if it was Obama that Article 2 says the president can do anything he or she wants. And, you know, that's a challenge that I'm setting for myself in the next presidency, that this president, whoever it is, restore the Constitution, not just try to go about implementing whatever policy agenda they want with no checks. And, you know, I say in the book, you know, basic income. OK, that's a good idea, I think, in many ways. But can a president just do it through executive order or emergency power? No. I don't know. Maybe there are people on the left. I see from many of the people that I'm talking to as I present on the book that there is a sort of version of the left that wants Bernie to assume dictatorial powers in the Bernie presidency. And, you know, I'm not for that. Do I think it would be better than a Trump presidency? Absolutely. But I'm not for the left taking on this idea that Article 2 gives the president dictatorial powers. We have a system in place that is governed by the rule of law. And even if that means that your preferred policy view is going to lose, I think, you know, too bad. That's the way that it works.
Yeah, but that's neoliberal hogwash, what you're spouting. Bernie is not a totalitarian. He's not asking.
It doesn't have to be Bernie. It could be anybody. It can be Joe Biden or Obama. But,
I mean, he's got the executive order pen, and that's it, basically.
Right.
Okay, this is my question, and then we're going to wrap it up.
Okay.
What's working against Trump is it's more satisfying for him to lose and to get locked up. That's a better show. And I'm being serious. You think
he'd prefer to be locked up if the ratings are high? That's what you're saying?
I think that is the petard upon which he'll be hoisted.
Wow, that'll be some end to the story. It's certainly been interesting, and that would be, wow. Historians would be writing about this for a long time.
Okay. No question. Last question. This is my big final question. This is why you do my show, for this question. If he's reelected, okay, what is the show? What is the show if he's reelected? Another impeachment? Suppose we impeach him now. He's exonerated. Then he's reelected. It's 2021. Is there double jeopardy? Can a president be impeached twice?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. I think because there's no, you know, to me, double jeopardy is a good rule and certainly a constitutional requirement when it comes to the criminal law. But I don't think it applies in a case of impeachment because the stakes are different. And it's the same reason why the standard isn't beyond a reasonable doubt. It's something probably more like preponderance of the evidence. Being fired is not the same as going to jail. Do something on the job that is a dereliction of duty. You don't have a right to that thing, your dereliction being proven beyond a reasonable doubt. You know, you have to have evidence maybe presented against you in your workplace, depending on your contract, if you can only be fired for cause. But it's you don't have a right to the same process that you would if you were being imprisoned. And when it comes to the president, this is the manager of the American people. There is no requirement even of cause firing. If we have good reason to think that he or she has failed in their basic duties to uphold the Constitution, certainly if we think there's a good chance they committed a crime, they can be removed. And yes, I think that the rule of double jeopardy is a criminal justice rule, not one that applies when it comes to this question that we're talking about. Do you keep the most powerful job in the world?
Corey Brettschneider is the author of The Oath in the Office, A Guide to the Constitution for Future Presidents. He is a professor of political science at Brown, visiting professor of law at Fordham Law School. He holds a law degree from Stanford, a master's in philosophy from Cambridge, a PhD in political science from Princeton, and currently holds the Morty Gunty Chair in Home Economics at Feldman University, FU. Thank you, sir. Thank you for doing this.
Please hold the line so we can talk about the HR issues.
You're not teaching a summer course at FU.
What do you say? Stay on the line?
Can you stay on the line?
I can to discuss HR. Please connect me to HR.
Okay. Stay on the line.